what's going on? Welcome back to Auto Transport Intel. It is Wednesday. It is noon Central Time, and that means it's time for DOT compliance. So if you have an authority question, a DOT number, IFTA, IRP, ELD, FMCSA, clearinghouse, how about a scale question or problem? Maybe you got a problem right now. Maybe you have a question right now. Maybe you're facing fees, fines, violations, and other fun things. I know it's not fun, but we do have a show for 30 minutes every Wednesday. We're live and we're here. Brian Riker, your DOT guy, wants to help. So here's what you want to do. Do me a favor. Go ahead and leave a like for the show. Thank you so much. Then, below the video, click share, click copy, grab that YouTube link, text it, email it, share it on social media, send it to a friend. Just send it to one person that you know has an issue. They don't know what they're doing. You know they don't know what they're doing. They're going to end up with a problem. So send them the link, help them out, be a friend. And if you've got deep, burning business questions, go to autotransportintel.com, click on sign up, become an ATI insider, talk to Ty, get some business information about, are you starting up? Are you trying to grow your business? You want to join the roundtable? Tuesday night, we have a super spreader. That's going to be amazing. What's a super spreader? Well, you can find out. I think Ty, he should be here in the live chat saying hello. And if not, let me know and I'll send you the link so you can talk to Ty. Hey, what's going on? Chris Chamberlain. Hey, Jay and Brian. Question to Brian regarding all trailer regulations. Cool. So right out of the box, Chris has a question. That's awesome. We're going to get to that in 1 second. I just want to finish saying hello to all two of you guys in the live chat. Devin from Victory Lap Transport, top of the morning. What's going on, Devin? Thanks for saying hello. Hey, Brian, just got a two-car Kaufman. We have two questions already. That's cool. Two people, two questions. We're not worried about a giant group. If we can help just you or a friend or somebody you know, that's what this is all about. So let's do it. Let's bring in Brian. Brian, can you see me and hear me okay?
Yes, I can, Jay. Good afternoon.
All right. Hey, good afternoon. Thank you for taking the time. I know you're at the, where are you?
I am at the Florida Tow Show, which is Lake Buena Vista, Florida, Orlando, Disney Springs Resort area. It's our first major live event for the towing and automotive recovery industry since December of 2019. So today's pre-show getting set up, show has a soft opening tomorrow afternoon, and exhibits are open Friday and Saturday. It's free to attend. If you're in the Florida area, come on down. It's focused to the towing industry, but there are some trailers here, not trailers, but there are some detachable gooseneck trailers, Landall traveling axle trailers. There, I haven't been out to the show floor. It's in a parking lot at the Hilton at Lake Buena Vista. There may even be a four-car carrier rollback or two here, but it's a good time. It's family friendly, and there's great exhibitors here representing all the different brands of towing equipment. I'm wandering around the show. There's free education going on. A lot of what happens in the towing industry transfers over to the hotshot and the car haul industry. And come on, it's Florida. It's sunny. It's beautiful. The weather's nice, and the state is open.
You can say people are actually walking around. It's normal.
Yes.
Like, wow. That must be awesome.
I'm enjoying it. Last year, I hit 44 out of 48 of the lower states during COVID, and it was a miserable experience. This year's getting a little bit better, but I've been in Florida 2 days now, and Florida is almost like normal.
That's the thing, is that things are going to get normal. We're going to get back on track. We're going to have life again. I do believe all those things. And so it's cool that there you are, you're at the Florida Tow Show. And again, I've been to Matt's. I haven't been to many outdoor shows. I've been to more indoor trade association, discussion, breakout sessions, main speaking mm-hmm. halls, right? But the outdoor shows, right, you get to see equipment, you get to talk to people. Do they also have like breakouts and workshops?
Oh, yes. This is a mixed indoor-outdoor event. They have classrooms inside. There are workshops. There are legislatively focused issues. There are compliance and regulatory focused. I am not a speaker at this event, but I'm here. I know that at least two folks that tune into this show are going to be down here to meet me in person because they've contacted me privately. A couple of my customers are going to be here. And it's Matt's on a much, much smaller scale with some cool stuff. If you just like equipment, there's live demos. I don't know what's going to happen this year, but in years past, they have rolled tractor trailers and cement mixers over and stood them back up with wreckers and rotators. And so there's all sorts of action, but I don't want to eat up all the time talking about this, but great event.
And I'm curious about it. So, all right, so last thing I'm going to ask you about it. What would you say are the top three things that you hear people talking about? Is it fuel? Is it insurance?
Insurance is a major issue in the towing industry, just like the trucking industry. So we hear about insurance. We hear about getting qualified, competent drivers, and towing industry hires CDL as well as non-CDL drivers. They're having the same problem you guys are, finding people willing and able to work that have a clean record and can pass a drug test. And the number three issue is safety, and that's roadside safety. You have on average one tow operator struck and killed every 6 days in the United States because people just are not paying attention. We have the same problem loading cars. There have been folks, we talked about this on a previous show, there have been folks struck and killed loading their car hauler because the dealer doesn't make room for us in their parking lot or whatever. But the towing industry, they have a major safety issue where everyone just whizzes by them at 70 miles an hour on the highway, and they're drifting off onto the shoulder and hitting and killing these people. And we just can't have that happen.
Okay. All right. No, those are good topics. I mean, they're not good topics, but they're important topics. Okay. Let's move on to Chris. Chris Chamberlain. Hey, Jay and Brian. Question to Brian regarding all trailer regulations. Is that found on the FMCSA website? I just purchased a 3-car, 48-foot ultralight and a 2-car trailer. Great deal for both. So is looking for information regarding trailer regulations.
Okay, well, there's some federal motor carrier regulations that apply to trailers, such as inspecting of the trailer, required equipment that must work, parts and equipment necessary for safe operation. As far as registered weight and licensing regulations, those vary by state depending on where you're based in for the registration. And if you're getting at overhang or anything like that, that varies based on the state that you're actually in at that moment when you're being inspected. So there is no one source for your trailer regulations. Some of it is just general 390, which is Federal Motor Carrier Safety Regulations, general information that applies to trucking companies. Some of it is lease and interchange if you're going to be pulling someone else's trailer or having someone that doesn't, you not your truck, pulling these trailers you bought. There's a whole bunch of places where you'll find trailer regulations. If you're looking for what you can load on it, overhang, height, width, that varies state by state. So you have to dig through each individual state's vehicle code. There is no one resource that has it all for you. The closest to one resource that has that type of information is the front of a printed copy of the Rand McNally Motor Carrier Atlas. That'll give you a very brief overview of what overall combination vehicle length laws are in each state, and even some cases whether they allow overhang or not. One of my side projects is to actually compile all this information into a guidebook. I haven't got there yet.
So these questions, because I was actually wondering, what's the effect of these questions on the way you think, do business, what you think about? Is this helpful for you also in your business?
Absolutely. I need to know what people beyond my immediate customers are concerned with. I know what I was concerned with when I had my trucks and operated my trucks, but those concerns have changed. Enforcement patterns have changed. For years, they left overhang alone on car haulers, and now it's a new enforcement campaign again since about 2015, 2016. They've really been cracking down on overhang, especially on traditional automobile transporters, your high mount trailers. In fact, I just saw a post on Facebook yesterday about Ohio claiming that someone was surprised Ohio said his trailer was illegal, and Ohio's absolutely correct. It may be a purpose-built automobile transporter. It's a, I think it was a Cottrell 7 or 8 car trailer, but
this one.
No, that's not. No, that.
That's different. Okay,
we can do that one in a sec.
We'll come back. Okay.
Without the ability to carry a car over your cab, there is no overhang guaranteed by federal regulation. So one last answer on this trailer. If you're looking for trailer regulations on a federal basis, you're not going to find very many unless you are actually qualified as an automobile transporter and meet the definition that Federal Highway Administration sets, which means you have to be able to carry power or carry a vehicle on your power unit over to somewhere on your truck, whether it's over the cab or immediately behind the cab like a Stinger does. And then you're guaranteed some overhang and you get some federal trailer laws that apply. Otherwise, it's strictly state by state and it varies as you drive across the country.
Chris does mention, he confesses, we did have a call, but I never leave to memory what you can write down or print out. So looks like you did talk to Chris about the trailer stuff, but you know, right? Some of this stuff requires follow-up. No problem at all. Thank you, Chris, for the question. And also, I put Brian's link, fleetcompliancesolutions.net. It's in the live chat, so if you need further help. Devin is next. Hey, Brian, just got my two-car Kaufman. Can I register and title it in Maine without any trouble from the DOT?
Generally, yes. The DOT, except in your home state, normally doesn't care where the trailer is registered. And I answered the question that way because there are a few states that are having problems with Maine trailer registrations. And I don't know where you're based out of, but New York is one of them that New York State Police, which also do motor carrier enforcement, are looking at your, they're looking at your fact you're based in New York State and the trailer's registered out of state, they want their pound of flesh, meaning they want their taxes. Most other states could care less.
All right. Let's see. We're cooking along. We have questions. So, yeah, feel free. You know, as I say, ask your question. Share your thoughts. Grow your business. We do want your DOT compliance questions. If we run out of questions, we also have some news articles to cover. So we've covered all of our bases. But next I've got, let's go back here in the live chat. And if you don't get the full answer you're looking for, you know, again, there's the link to Brian, or feel free to put a follow-up question. Devin says, is it okay to remove Kaufman name off the trailer and put my company name for advertising purposes?
That's yes. Yes. There's no regulation that says you have to have the model or manufacturer name on the trailer. You can take their decal off, as long as it's not built into part of the required safety decal, the reflectors that have to be on the side of the trailer. So you can peel that Kaufman name off. You can put your stuff up there. The only thing you can't remove is the trailer data plate, which has the VIN and axle rating and all that on it. But their little sticker they put up in the front, you can take that off and put whatever you want up there.
So you can change Volvo to Olvo and that's okay.
Yes.
All right. Okay. Just clarification there. Okay, so question for Brian. I have to pick up my new trailer in Texas. Do I have to log on duty for this ride?
Yes, it's a business purpose. You're going down to Texas to pick the trailer up, even if you're not hauling a load. Going there and coming back is still a DOT-regulated interstate trip. So you will need to have your DOT number, your truck lettered. You'll have to comply with hours of service. This is a great segue right into what you put up a few seconds ago, Jay, on trailer registration. You can also have some problems when you're coming home from Texas if you're only on a temporary in-transit plate hauling a load. So I can expand upon that when we discuss this one news story here. But yes, the short answer to your question is, it is a fully DOT regulated trip to go pick up your new equipment.
Let's go ahead and jump into this. Hey, guys, I need an attorney recommendation that can help me fight a bogus overweight ticket in Connecticut, although I have a CDLA and a temporary authority on my newly purchased commercial 5500 truck.
All right. I read this one. I read the whole story. I actually replied to this. And in this particular person's case, they were cited for being 17,000 pounds overweight on an allegedly empty trailer. And I say it that way because he says he was empty in one part, but then numbers he puts up further on in the thread don't make any sense because they add up to about 36,000 pounds, where an empty 5500 and wedge trailer should be somewhere in the 17 to 19,000 pound range. So what happened here, this is a prime example of dealers not always giving you the right information. He bought this truck, he bought this trailer, but he was operating on a temporary registration. He was waiting for New York State to send him his hard apportioned registration plate. So he's operating on a temporary registration from the dealer, which those are only designed in most states to allow you to operate the vehicle empty to get it from the dealership back to your house or back to your place of business. You are not allowed to haul weight on those permits. In some states, you can't even use that temporary permit on your newly purchased pickup truck to go bring your newly purchased trailer home. So what happens in Connecticut, the truck was not registered with an apportioned plate, an IRP plate, and he had the trailer behind it. So Connecticut considers that an overweight, as in over registered weight condition, not over what the truck can handle. And they cite you for being over your registered weight because the truck was not registered at all. Now, the officer could have chose to just simply write him for not having the proper registration credential and let it go. But writing it this way at 17,000 pounds overweight, it's a pay per pound fine. And it works out to be something like a $2,000 or $3,000 fine for that, where the no registration citation is like $150 fine. So again, just because you bought the truck and the state's running behind getting you your official credentials doesn't mean you can actually go out and use the truck for business purposes.
That is, and you know, because I'm tempted to ask you what you think of the, you know, citation. I mean, it's, you know, and we'll just skip that because it's opinion, it's rhetoric. What we do know is that individual by individual officer, you're going to have different case situations, but overall there was a violation.
Yes, there was a clear violation, and the office.
Oh, hang on, internet. Check. Let's see here. What's going on?
Since this violation covered under a cup.
We're okay. Can you hear me?
Now I can hear you, yes.
All right, cool. All right, so we had
I had the unstable message pop up, so I figured I'd just stop for a minute.
So perfect timing. Okay, so going again, take two.
I love that. When'd you get...
Isn't that amazing? Oh, man.
So this is where truly understanding compliance is a benefit to your business, because the dealer, they mean well, but the average person buying the 5500 is buying it from the consumer auto retail auto dealer who doesn't understand DOT compliance. Yeah, here, take your plate, go. And you know, if you were towing your personal camper behind the truck, Connecticut probably wouldn't even have cared. But because we're a commercial vehicle, we're held to a higher standard. The officer has discretion. There were multiple violations here, overweight and unregistered vehicle. And maybe the officer thought he was doing him a favor by citing him for overweight. Because if he cites him for unregistered vehicle, he has to have the vehicle towed out of the state, which would probably be more expensive than the weight. If he cites him for overweight, generally you're given a chance to correct it. Or in some states, they cite you for overweight and it's just like buying a weight permit for the day and you can carry on. So I don't know what the officer's thought process was in this citation, but on the surface, it does feel crazy to a trucker to get an overweight ticket on an empty truck. But by the letter of the law, the way it's designed, he was over his registered weight since there was no valid registration for part of his combination.
You said something really key right there. As a commercial vehicle driver, you are held to a higher standard. And maybe that's an important thing to, you know, it's like whether you're a priest or a professor or whatever, right? Whether you think so or not, you are held to a higher standard. I think what, and this is where you got into like roadside safety. If we're going to be held to a higher standard, can we get everybody else to drive reasonable?
I wish we could, Jay. I really do. And
tap a bell and everybody does it.
Expanding upon the held to a higher standard, I just saw before we came on air in one of the forums, somebody asking how they could get their commercial driver's license in Texas because they recently had a citation in their personal car for 96 in a 55, I believe it was. And they're disqualified from getting their CDL in Texas. Well, again, if you intend to be a commercial driver, you intend to be a professional driver with or without a commercial driver's license, you need to act like one even in your personal car. We all love toys. I had a thing that I loved to run at triple digits, but I wouldn't do it on the public highway. We all love our toys. We love to play, but we have to remember that we are held to a higher standard since this is our profession.
That's in 96 and a 55. That is pretty, that there aren't many situations where that's going to be, you know, and now
it, you, it's not generally acceptable.
No, I mean, that's really a lot. 96 and a 55. So basically now you were part of the general population problem and you want to graduate to, you know, anyways, that is, I'm not here to judge, but 96 and a 55. I don't think I've ever done that. Honestly, that's a lot. Okay, we got a couple more questions here. Let's see. Let's go into live chat. This is an interesting question. Brian, what do you think about Detroit Wrecker and their equipment?
Can we depending ask on what depending on what you're doing with it, they make some awesome equipment. I work for a competing distributor. However, I will give them their props when their props are due. And their low loader is an awesome piece of equipment if you're going to be moving heavily modified lowrider vehicles or you're going to be moving extreme exotics because you get an almost 0 degree load angle. It's very similar to how they load them on the race car haulers and the enclosed car trailers where you're just pushing them up onto a ramp and then lifting them straight up. They make a great product that way. My only concern, and this is not a dig at them at all, I know the folks up there, my only concern is because they are a very small company, parts availability and lead times to get equipment or specialty parts that they may not have in stock could be a lot longer than one of your larger equipment manufacturers just because of the nature of the business. I love little guys. There's nothing wrong with dealing with a little guy. They have a decent product, especially when you're in that little specialty niche. So that's what I think about their equipment.
That was a really good answer. Maybe the takeaway then is just make sure you're near or in touch with the closest facility because there's going to come a day where you need a part.
And that's true about anything. When people ask, what truck should I buy? Well, what dealership do you have in your hometown? And what dealerships do you have along the route you run? I wouldn't buy a Peterbilt if the nearest Peterbilt dealer is 100 miles away. And you've got a Freightliner dealer in your hometown, or same thing for Ram versus Chevy versus Ford. And you have to look at the service ability.
Now, wait a minute. Ram versus Chevy versus Ford. Now you've gone too far. Okay. So John Cochran asks, if I have a CDL Class B, can I operate an F-350 with a 3 or 4 car hauler?
You can, as long as you keep that F-350 at the non-CDL weight limit, because the only difference between your CDL-B and a non-CDL license is the weight that you can operate on the power unit. And in fact, it restricts you even more, because if you look at the back of your license, it's going to say your Class B is good for any single vehicle, 26,000 pounds and greater, provided you're not towing anything over 10,000 pounds. And so when you take that 350 and that trailer, if you can keep it under 26 total, you're good, because they'll treat your license just like it's not a CDL. But if you exceed 26, you need the Class A. So you'd have to go take your road test again to add the Class A endorsement or Class A to your license.
Here's a good one. Brian, what does Mr. DOT look for in your ELD daily logs? Or what is good practice in form and manner to stay compliant?
They look for everything that's supposed to be on your paper log. So they're going to look for shipping ID or document. They're going to look that your city and state were flagged properly. They're going to look that you flagged a pre and a post trip inspection. Excuse me. So to avoid form and manner, most ELD devices will highlight and tell you something's missing, something's not quite right. Fill in all the blanks. Don't use abbreviations, except you can use postal abbreviations. So you can abbreviate the state, NYPAIL, and you can abbreviate the directions, NSWE. But don't abbreviate, say, the city of Albuquerque, which nobody wants to write that word out. Out there, it's common to abbreviate it ABQ. That is not acceptable on your log. Now, granted, your ELD is supposed to enter location information automatically. So what the DOT officer looks for is all the blanks are filled in. And then when they take your record and you send it to them electronically, they put it in a computer program that's going to look for any anomalies, like you unplugged your device and plugged it back in. Be prepared to explain that. There's a major jump in the odometer reading, your ending odometer reading, the last time the ELD logged in, it comes back on a day later and there's 1,000 miles in there. Be ready to explain what happened there. That's what they look for. So they look for shipping dock and carrier profile information, which normally on an ELD you only have once, so that it has your full name, it has your motor carrier's name and address that you're working for, truck trailer identification, which can be a company assigned number to the truck and trailer. It can be the license plate number. Now, if you're going to cross the border into Canada, they have some other very specific requirements that I am not an expert in, but I know that Canada requires the odometer reading to actually be recorded on the log, and I believe the license plate. But that's all they look for, is just that the blanks are filled in. If you have a compliant ELD, it's going to ask you and prompt you for all of the information you need to make a complete log. If you're pushing no or skipping over something it's asking you, then most likely, unless it has to do with a co-driver and you're not running two drivers in the truck, most likely you're skipping over an important field you're supposed to fill out.
I think it's a great question, and I like the length of the explanation. And as much as I dislike my ELD punch, I drank it all, is that, you got to keep thinking about this ELD. Well, I got one more question. We got, man, only like one more minute here. Fritz asks, Brian, my buddy, non-CDL setup is 26,000. Current weight in North Carolina scale was 21K. They put him out of service for not having a CDL. They said the trailer GVWR was over 10K. And is a CDL needed?
Not in North Carolina, no. If he was in California and had a California license, yes. So unless he has a license from one of the handful of states, such as California, that limit the non-CDL driver to a trailer less than 10,000 pounds, that probably was an incorrect citation. To give you an exact answer, I would need a copy of the citation, the scale ticket, a copy of the front and back of his driver's license so I can make sure there's no special restriction on it, and the truck and trailer registration to make sure that they didn't somewhere in there put in some false information accidentally that led to them writing a violation, or that your buddy didn't accidentally miss something on his truck and trailer combination or misunderstand the officer. Because just because he's physically under 26,000 pounds, remember, the ratings of the truck and trailer together must still be under 26. And this is where a lot of guys get in trouble. You'll have a pickup truck rated at 14 or 15,000 pounds, which if it's 14, which is the most common one, you can only have an exactly 12,000 pound trailer. A lot of these trailers come through from the manufacturers at 12,500 to 14,000 pound rating. and you have to get them derated from the manufacturer before you put them on the road. Otherwise, your truck and trailer together, the rating exceeds 26,000. And then, yes, if the trailer's over 10,000 rating, it becomes a Class A vehicle, regardless of what its actual weight is when it crosses the scale. And that's what trips up so many people, is the concept of actual weight versus weight rating. And for licensing purposes, the weight rating is the first thing they look at. That has to be right, meaning below 26 total and before they consider anything else. Then if your physical weight gets over that, in some cases, they will still require you to have a CDL, depending upon the state you're in.
My gut instinct is that the DOT officer saw a detail that the driver did not.
Most of these officers are experts on this, and they very rarely get this wrong. Yeah. But if you want to have your buddy scan his vehicle and trailer registration, picture the door plate in the truck and the trailer, scale ticket, citation, license, and email it to me at my website, yourdotguy.com. I'll gladly look at it and see what he missed, because maybe we can use it as a teaching moment here on a future show.
Yeah, no, it is. And I'm going to ask, John jumped in. Is that the rating before being loaded with cars? That's a question from John.
The rating is what the manufacturer's declared gross vehicle weight rating is for truck and the plate for the trailer. You add the two of them together, and that has to be under 26 to be a non-CDL vehicle. Well, 26,000 or under to be a non-CDL vehicle.
Hey, Brian, if you've got time, I know I'm putting you on the spot here, but next Tuesday night, we do have our Super Spreader Roundtable. If you've got time, we'd love to have you join us, because I'm sure you're going to hear a lot of questions about these types of topics. So please keep that in mind if you're available to join us.
Sure.
Cool. Okay. Well, listen, we're out of time here. That was awesome. I feel like we covered a lot of ground. And and John's got a follow-up. Can I email back if my driver's license can let you know what I can haul? So I'll tell you what, John, I put Brian's link, fleetcompliancesolutions.net. Go ahead and send him an email, and Brian will let you know, what next steps or what you guys need to do. Brian, you probably get all kinds of different kinds of emails, right? From just I don't know what's going on, to I've been in business for years and I got a problem and I'm not sure what to do, right?
Oh, absolutely. Well, I'm down here, I have a customer visit with a gentleman over in Daytona area. He's been in business 50 years, but he's having compliance issues. This isn't just a new business problem. Even the guy's been around a very long time, get it wrong from time to time.
Yeah, and then you need an expert. So, Brian, thank you so much for being our resident expert on DOT compliance. And we didn't even get to the news stories. I think we had more questions today. This might be one of the highest rated number of question shows we've had in a while. So really great. Great to see the interaction.
Brian, I love it.
Yeah, I do too. Enjoy the rest of the show and say hi to Florida for me. Say hi to people for me.
I'll say hi to freedom for you, Jay. Yeah. It's free down here.
That is so cool, man. I'm so jealous.
Have a great one. Thanks.
You too, man. Take care, dude. See ya. All right, we let Brian go, and you guys stay safe. And if you're in the area, if you're anywhere near Orlando or Kissimmee, and or just Google Florida Tow Show and say hi to Brian. And please do join us tomorrow on Dispatching Live. And as Mark Grodicke put in the live chat, 96 and a 55 stops you from getting a CDL, but you can still be a dispatcher. Stay safe, everybody. We'll see you soon.